Growing up on this farm was the greatest experience in the world. Just a wonderful place to be. It's pretty much a Huckleberry Finn life around here for children. Most of our heroes were like cowboys, and I have still my Hopalong Cassidy and my Cisco Kid autographed picture. I think they were worthy of kids' emulations. We played soldier. We made hand grenades out of discarded beer cans and filled them with sand. I'd been shot at a million times before I ever joined the Army. And at one point, I really asked myself, do I really have to kill this guy? He had done everything that he could as a soldier. And I suppose if there's one thing I regret, I had to kill him, but he had my respect. If the sun came up, we were all dead. And we still had three men missing. Hubia Guillory, David Scott, and Danny Callie. But missing to us means you get the bodies back.
The story we're here to tell today is about another 7th Cavalry battle that occurred 3 years after the Iodrang and took place in the A Shau Valley to the north. It was a hard day. The 7th Cavalry sees hard days in combat. It has for over a century. And this day was going to be one of those. Before the sun had set, the 1st Cavalry Division had lost more helicopters in one day than had ever been lost in a day before or since. So they had their work cut out for them. In this case, the 5th of the 7th Cavalry was going against the best that North Vietnam had, and it was going to be a bloody, costly affair.
A Shau Valley had been the key area under NVA, VC and NVA control, primarily NVA, for the last 2 years or more, and they had ammunition caches and readiness training areas and all kind of things, and they would go down it and go into Way from the northeast down, I think, right 547. Into the city of Way, and that's where they brought in all the troops that for the Battle of Way and for the T.T. Woods and all the fight that went on there during the Tet Offensive. Those troops were introduced in, and their mission was to take over the Imperial City of Way and then declare that the NVA was in control in South Vietnam.
The 1st of the 9th Air Cav had been conducting the aerial preparation of the battlefield. Our mission going into the A Shau Valley was essentially this. sees Tiger High Mountain block the road coming in from the west, from Laos. And in the last day or so before our assault on the 19th, they put in, I believe it was 100 airstrikes. We were flying in front of the formation. And I looked back, and it was just, you know, to a professional soldier like me, the whole thing was magnificent. I mean, there were 40 birds across the sky, and here we come, you know? And all of a sudden, all these tracers start going straight up past the front canopy. Red tracers everywhere, lots.
What was supposed to happen is we were supposed to come in and touch his kids. The grunts would take out. Well, that didn't happen. The grunts just started climbing down on the skids, hanging by their arms, and dropping to the ground. And I look out the window on the right door, and the North Vietnamese were all over the place. I can still see their faces looking at us, obviously NCOs or officers pointing at us, and I can see the muzzle flashes.
When we approached the LZ, there was automatic weapon fire hitting all over the LZ. There was really no place to put the skids down, and the birds just hovered at 10 or 12 foot. It seemed a lot higher at the time. I threw my rucksack off, and I bailed out right behind it. I was standing near Captain Miles when he was shot with a 51 caliber. It was very chaotic, it's all, you know, and trying to group, regroup, whatever, get everybody where you needed to be was very difficult.
We were jumping. I mean, I threw my pack at about probably 25 feet, and at about 20 feet, I jumped just to get off of the helicopter, because we could hear the 51 caliber bullets just snapping all around us.
I exited the aircraft, I suppose, at about 20 feet that time and landed in a bomb crater. And the aircraft hit and rolled over, but the blades continued. And that's not an easy feeling when you see that large rotor blade coming at your head. Then a call came in that a gunship had been shot down. The North Vietnamese were on the roads above us shooting. The crew chief was upset because he couldn't fire up at them. The gunship crew was running up the hill shooting back at them. The door gunners shooting, and a lot of stuff happening.
I'm looking out to the east, and here comes this line of hooks in single column. You can see them coming. First hook gets right out of the middle of the valley. Boom, it is surrounded by little black puffs of smoke. Fire starts in the back of the Chinook, and he immediately noses down into it. And he just goes spiraling down.
When the chief said, "Sir, we're on fire, we're burning bad," I remember looking back, and all I could see was roiling black smoke and flames. And that's, I didn't look back after that. You know, occasionally a fireball would sort of roll through the cockpit.
The other pilot and I looked at one another. We could tell something had happened because we could feel it. And it was shortly thereafter that the flight engineer told me that the aircraft was on fire. And I asked him about the other crew members, and he told me that they had jumped out. And it seemed at the time like nothing unusual. It seemed like a thing to do. It was very hot, very scary, and we knew we were going to die. They made a decision to die a little bit differently than we did.
I have no idea how we lived through it.
One of my RTOs, who was fairly new to me, young guy, I don't think he'd been with us that long, I look over and he's crying. He's in tears, you know, and he turns to me and he says, "Sir, this is terrible. This is just, oh," you know, he had tears running down his face. You know, I think I said something like, "Yeah, war really is terrible, and all you can do is just keep on doing your job."
At that point, there was a Chinook that was coming in, bringing supplies for us. It all of a sudden dropped and landed very hard on the ground and caught fire.
Helicopter caught on fire, and I was trapped in the back of the helicopter. Four guys went down under enemy fire, constant fire, dragged me out of that helicopter, and pulled me back up to the side of that mountain. Had it not been for those four guys, I wouldn't be here today talking to you.
Mike Sprayberry and a couple other guys went back to the back of the helicopter, which was on fire, and found this guy laying there unconscious in the back of the helicopter. I felt like he was either dead or in the process of dying. I said, oh my God, I gotta give him something for his pain, because I'm sure he's in horrendous pain. But then our company commander said, you know, we gotta keep moving down the road here. We gotta keep moving. So I shot him up with morphine. I covered him with the poncho and left him laying there on the side of the road. A heavy lift helicopter slinging a bulldozer went right over where the notch was at up ahead of us. It was a notch up ahead of us. And that, he took a lot of fire and was shot down as well. Sky cranes are a huge helicopter, and to watch that one get shot down and crash was truly, we were thinking, my gosh, we've now seen two Chinooks go down, we've seen a sky crane go down, we've seen a couple of our Hueys go down. This is pretty devastating to the air mobile unit that we were a part of. We found several bombed out trucks that were full of brand new cases of brand new AK-47s and RPGs. So we were pretty impressed by what we found that first day. And we took bunker after bunker. We killed several North Vietnamese soldiers along the way.
The road was cut right in the side of the mountain. On the right, it was straight up, and on the left, it was straight down. It had the I had the feeling that I was being, or we were being watched. So I stopped the rest of the company behind me. Coming down this road, there were NVA troops, and they were in ranks. Now, if they were four wide, five wide, six wide, I have no idea. But all I can say is they were in ranks, and there were probably 20 of them long. But they were marching down the road, and the second one come over the hill, and the third one was coming over the hill, and I says to this young fella, I said, if we're gonna get out of here, it's gonna be now.
The word came back to me, obviously, of what was out there, and so we knew that we were gonna have a problem going on a one or two man front, and they had their positions in place, and engaged us and ambushed the lead platoon.
And there was no cover. I mean, when you're on that road, it's just like you were in a shooting gallery. I mean, you'd come around the corner and they were dug in and you were open and there was no cover. I mean, you couldn't get cover. You just couldn't hardly move.
There was no way that we were gonna move forward the way we were already trying to. And we had a cliff on one side of the road and a cliff on the other side of the road.
Captain Lambert had asked that the first platoon of the company go up over the side of the mountain to the right of us, go forward and come down on the notch that was up ahead. We could see it up ahead of us on the road where the road kind of curved around towards it.
And I'm looking at that deal and I'm thinking, that's gonna be a hard to get up. It was a hard climb, basically going straight up and getting all the way to the top of that ridge, and it was slow going, you know. You don't have to be on the point guided, I mean, all back through there, you know. Even if you're a few people back or all the way back to the back, you never let your guard down.
To me, it was really, really scary because it was no noise. And the troops were behind us. And I remember the lieutenant and I squatted there at the edge of the jungle just trying to assess the situation because this was much more serious than what we anticipated. I told the lieutenant, you go here, I'll go here. He went 10 feet and they killed him. Sorry. And so, they killed him.
All hell broke loose. They just started firing everything they had at us.
once they got, Herb and Scott got to that road, it was like they were in, right in the open, you know. Scott, he went down first, and Herb, and he just raised his rifle up, and he went down with probably a couple rounds, and I seen him just fall over, and we hollered, you know, we could not get any response. I couldn't, you know, out of him. I tried.
We got this initial ambush. And in that ambush, the company commander, the forward observer, his radio operator, I believe this guy was Kelly, and several other people were wounded.
And I have to say, I have never seen as many hand grenades in the air at one time in my entire life. And I yelled grenade as loud as I could, and I dropped flat. Captain Lambert didn't get down, but the grenade exploded then. And I felt a real hot, searing pain in my right leg and looked down and I could see my femur because a piece of the shrapnel had hit my leg and I thought, oh my gosh, I'm wounded a little bit. So I had a field dressing right here in the front. I just grabbed it and slapped it on there and tied it in place. But I looked forward at Captain Lambert and he was really shredded.
When he realized he was hit, he didn't stop. You know, he kind of bandaged himself up a little bit and kept trying to administer first aid to the ones that he could get to.
The bullets were just snapping all around us. There was no more grenades that were thrown, thank God. So I crawled forward to Captain Lambert, and I started dressing his wounds and gave him a little shot of morphine. And all of a sudden, I felt a bullet hit my hip. And I was thrown into a small bomb crater. Thank God for that, because I was below the line of fire.
To me, the bravest man I've ever met, wide open under all this fire, and he's on his knees giving me morphine. And I'll never forget, he said, "Oh, sir, my God," or something to that effect, because it was a flesh wound, but it was probably pretty ugly.
Well, I knew I was not going to move, because I knew the femur was broke. The big muscles started contracting immediately, and the jagged edges of the bone were just kind of being pulled together. I'd never been in such pain. I remember praying to die. I asked God, please let me die.
At the time of the ambush, I was pretty much clueless as to what was going on. It just seemed to be another firefight. I knew it was our guys, and I knew that they were somewhere over there in a firefight. Not much else until my RTO says, you know, six, which was the company commander's been hit, and they've got casualties, and it's an ambush.
One of my RTOs taps me on the shoulder. He'd just gotten a message on the radio from D Company saying that Rough Rider 5, that's XO, is going to take a patrol, would like to take a patrol, and go up the highway and take out any enemy that gets in their way and get to the platoon and bring them out. And I listened to that and realized that was the only thing there was to do.
We decided that we would do it at night and at least have some advantage. We had seen the terrain leading somewhere into the area for 2 days and knew that we had a fair chance. One of the guys came up to me and said, "I'm going with you." I said, "No, we've got too many people." He says, "Well, sir, I'm going anyway. What do you want me to do?" When you have people that have that intensity, you have the at least a hope that you're going to succeed. But in all honesty, I could not say that anyone that went up that road would be coming back. The cut in the bank was lined with what are called spider holes. Just little places, one-man positions, two-man positions, where people hide to avoid artillery fire or to protect themselves from direct gunfire.
Lieutenant Sprayberry is about, 20, 30 feet in front of us, feeling along the side of the hill, trying to find them spider holes.
And at some points, you could hear people crawling back and forth from one bunker to the other. You could hear people breathing.
you could hear different encounters in the night, that the silence, the dead silence, you'd hear the guys moaning who were wounded and weren't dead or whatever. But you would hear an encounter.
You know, in an hour's time, we'd set off a half a dozen grenades, take several rounds of machine gun fire. He was almost right under one time when it went off, and he tossed a couple hand grenades up there, and we passed that, so they were knocked out.
I also wondered, as I heard the grenades and the small arms going off, who that was. Was it the enemy killing off my troops and just working their way to us? I really didn't know. I had no sense of distance. All I knew that it was getting closer and closer.
And it was dark. Black. I mean, black, dark. You couldn't see hardly nothing in front of you, you know. It was the whole time, boy, it was nerve-wracking, I'll tell you. It was scary. It was a scary night, probably the scariest night of my life.
We were at one point waiting on the initial link-up. I was on the radio with one of the platoon sergeant, and he was bringing himself and a couple of other guys up the road. And I had no idea at what distance he was, so I said, well, I'll whistle. And you whistle back so I can know exactly where you are. So I did, and I heard this whistle. Turns out, we see these shadows moving up the road. They thought we were Vietnamese, and we thought they were Americans. And they turn out to be Vietnamese. They walk up and start speaking Vietnamese to us. After we dispatched these guys that had come up to the road there, I guess thinking everything was clear, other guys had crawled into the bunkers adjacent to the road, right where we were standing, and just opened up on us big time. Just full automatic, close range, you know, point blank, and hit nobody except one of the medics in the foot. No matter what we did, it was almost as though we couldn't miss our targets and they couldn't hit theirs. But it's one of the oddest things, it's one of those things of war when you're looking at an AK and it's on full automatic, and I couldn't get my head in the hole, and you're just counting bullets, and all of a sudden they stop and they pick up on the other side. And it's one of those surreal moments when you think, am I dead? You know, little things like that go through your mind. At one point, I really asked myself, do I really have to kill this guy? Because he had done everything that he could as a soldier. And I suppose if there's one thing I regret having to do with regard to the enemy in my whole tour, was that he had to go. But you, things like that go through your mind. And I had to kill him, but he had my respect. I have to say that.
At this point, though, I still didn't know that it was Mike or the bad guys moving close to our position, because the last time the grenades went off and the small fire went off, it seemed to me that it was really getting close. And all of a sudden, and to me, it was closer than you or me. This head appears and said, "You okay?" I thought I was going to have a heart attack because it was Mike.
I'm sure there's me and a lot of other people didn't give ourselves very good odds of getting out of there. I mean, it didn't look good. You always pray for a miracle, but you know, and I guess we got one too. You know, when Mike came up. It's kind of like the Cavalry's coming, you know, is what that was.
But just the physical thing of getting people off of that hill carrying basically dead weight, even four guys carrying a 180-pound stretcher on an almost vertical terrain is an impossible task at night.
Four of them put their hands under me.
lifted me up and moved me over to the stretcher and got me on the stretcher and did a wonderful job. I just couldn't believe how gentle they were. It's like they were angels.
We had had to bring medical support up there in the dark to work on people on the road, not far in between the company and the ambush site. And I think they saved a lot of lives that night.
I knew that they couldn't have any lights on and he couldn't talk. So I was able to just use hand signals. I was able to then see and feel the veins in which I could get some IVs going. And we were carrying some of our own IVs in with us because the people who were there, already there in the location, they used up all their IV bottles already.
It was getting on into the early hours of the morning. If the sun came up, we were all dead. And we still had three men missing. But missing to us means you get the bodies back. We had wounded laying on the road. We couldn't get evacuation. We couldn't get resupply. We were low on ammo. The sun coming up, but still we have guys coming up and asking if they can make, you know, one more trip. So the answer is no.
There were some guys that we never did recover that night. David Scott, Hubia Guillory, and Danny Kelly.
The creed of the American soldier always is to never leave a man out there. You just don't ever want to do it because you don't want to be one that's left out there yourself. For those, Mike and Doc, and for those who at that time thought they had got everybody out, were getting us all out, must have felt terrible that they weren't able to get everyone out.
As it turned out a few days later, of course, when the weather broke, it had started to rain that night. We got a light observation helicopter, which after a briefing of, yes, we want them back, but in fact, when they landed, I knew what they were there for. We didn't ask for them, they just showed up. He simply said, well, you want them back, don't you? And Dan said, yeah.
And it took off and came right around in the front of my position. The crew waved at us, we waved back at them, and they were very low. And it wasn't 30 seconds later, we heard a 51 caliber open up and a lot of shooting. And then they were running around telling everybody to grab their light gear. And we had a chopper down. When we got up to the top, to the flat spot of the hill, I could see the chopper was maybe about 40 yards away. Didn't appear to be heavily damaged. And there was a North Vietnamese soldier crawling out the side door of it. Did not see any of the crew at that time.
We always maintained that up until the very end that we'd be able to get at some point back into the area and do that and recover the bodies. But that did not happen.
This rescue operation, which lasted approximately 7.5 hours, saved the lives of many of his fellow soldiers. Captain Sprayberry personally killed 12 enemy soldiers, eliminated 2 machine guns, and destroyed numerous enemy bunkers. Captain Sprayberry distinguished himself by exceptional bravery while serving as executive officer of Company D. Captain Sprayberry's indomitable spirit and gallant action at great personal risk to his life are in keeping with the highest traditions of the military service and reflect great credit upon himself, his unit, and the U.S. Army.
Veterans are people who are at one point wrote a blank check made payable to the United States of America. Thank you.
population of the town was about 300, 350 back then. The bank, barber shop, grocery store, it's pretty much all gone now. And we grew up in this home right here. It's where we all grew up. My parents bought it back in the early 50s, and we all grew up there. A lot of good memories there, yeah. Small town life, you know. He was dating a girl. I believe they were engaged, a girl by the name of Debbie. And I can remember them getting the notice and not being real happy about it, of course. You know, he wasn't looking forward to it, but he accepted it. And I can remember him going to Fort Leonard Wood for his basic training in Missouri. And I can remember shaking his hand and telling him goodbye when he left for Vietnam.
I remember when Dan left for Vietnam. That day I was actually going over to take the Catholic high school exams. He said goodbye to me at the door and we hugged and kissed. And he said, I'll be home. And I said, you better be. And he just was worried about me. He said, you better do good on that exam. And I said, I will. The truth of the matter is, he really believed in what John F. Kennedy said. He heard that speech, and all his friends heard it as well. And they really did believe in the domino theory. He truly believed in America, and he liked America being free, and he wanted to make sure that we all lived that way. Every night, they'd have the Vietnam War on. Every night. I mean, that the news showed Vietnam, how many casualties, things were going on. I mean, that. We just lived it day and night. It was awful, awful. As a child growing up, I thought it was terrible.
We watched the nightly news every day at night. It seemed like trying to keep an eye on the news to see if you'd see David, you know, in the hopes that, you know, there'd be something about his unit or something like that. And then, of course, after he turned up missing, then it was even more so, because you hoped that you'd turn the TV on and see something about, you know, them finding him or whatever.
We all knew if a car pulled up with two soldiers getting out of them, something was awry. And so I opened the door, and you can't even speak when you see them. And I just ran, and I got my mom. And that was it. They went into the parlor with my parents, and that's when they found out that Danny was missing.
You know, I remember a lot of tears from my mother and my dad being upset. And I think he had a much greater understanding of everything that was going on in Vietnam than any of us did, probably, but he held that in. He didn't talk about it, but that's when his attitude towards life kind of changed and stuff, and I think it probably shortened his life dramatically.
They didn't tell my parents much. It was pretty agonizing, and it was agonizing to watch my parents. I mean, it really destroyed us as a family. And of course, you know, you have all these kind of bizarre ideas, thinking that, well, maybe he is in a POW camp, maybe he is somewhere. And then as the years went on, I remember, this is a terrible thing to say, but I just didn't want him to suffer. And I remember praying to God one time and saying, please don't let him suffer, take him. We still didn't know if he was alive.
It's the unknown. You know, there's no final action. There's no closing. For whatever reason, I have grieved for my brother more than I ever did my dad, my mother. And I think it's because you don't have that closing. Thirty years of the cop, and I said, "Do this."
In the late '80s, I was sitting at my desk in Fort Knox, Kentucky, and the phone rang. And it was the son-in-law of one of our missing in action men, and to revisit the subject of what had happened to Danny Kelly. For all that time, I had thought that surely the families that had some answers, some closure, that we knew enough about the situation that a recovery would have been accomplished or would be accomplished.
I probably wasn't sure that he was dead until I got a phone call from Mike Sprayberry. And he said that the main reason that he was calling was answering the article that I had put in the ad that I had put in the newspaper, and he just wanted me to know that David was gone that day, that there wasn't any suffering, you know, he hadn't been held as a prisoner, and it had happened pretty quick.
He got in touch with us years ago. He talked with my parents, he's talked with all of us. My brothers have gone out and visited him, and he'll tell you he's just a farmer. He's more than a farmer, believe me. I think farming is probably his way of balancing out or calming. He loves this country. He loves these guys that went to Vietnam. And I think he considers them his family. He really does. He just feels that he's got to get them home.
We had men along with us who had been on that mountain in 1968, or who had had friends that were on that mountain and lost in 1968.
Our little group, I'm quite proud of them. We had a former pilot that was with the 1st of the 9th Cavalry to provide us technical expertise. We had an archaeologist retired from the Department of Interior. We had another member of our unit. We had people that had a personal interest in this. So not just a professional veneer, but a sincere interest in doing things right.
When JPAC began to try and find qualified archaeologists who would accompany their teams to Vietnam and supervise excavations in the hope of confirming that some of the list of MIAs had in fact been killed in the war, I was out the door. Well, I did one set of excavations up in the north just outside Hanoi and another one in the central highlands of the former South Vietnam.
After I was in the field for, I don't know, several weeks. And the captain called me up to the front. Captain wants to see you. He said, you're going in tonight to division. They want you. It was taken right out of the field, just like that. And I remember, you know, the helicopter waving to them, them waving to me. And I never saw them again. That's the scene that really has always stuck with me. With Scotty, I remember him smiling all the time. He smiled a lot. He was very quiet. He had brilliant blonde hair. It was almost like a shone in the sun, you know. I asked him for a cigarette once. He gave me his whole pack. That's what I remember. I met Hubie in AIT, Advanced Infantry Training at Fort Polk. A very small guy, but he was a big personality.
They let the patrol get right on this slope and down into it, and then sprang it.
Right there.
And the first two guys were down here, but everybody went to ground, and every time they stuck their heads out, you know, they got shot at some more. There just wasn't any place to go.
This heavy guilt began to take over. I felt this heavy sense of, I should have done this, I shouldn't have done that, if only I had done this. And somehow I had some responsibility for this disaster that happened to my friends. And I find that every surviving soldier feels this way to some degree or another. Some of us more than others, some longer than others. We didn't do enough. We should have done something we didn't do. We shouldn't have done something we did. They were better than we were. The dead ones are better than the living ones. It's all not logical. It doesn't make any sense, but it must be a human reaction because many of us feel that way. I was thinking, like, this looks so placid, you know? This does not look like the end of the world right here, which is what I felt it must have been like, and I'm sure it was. What I knew, what I felt was, having been in that spot, having seen it, that if I had been there, I would have been courageous. I would have done my job. I would have protected them as best I could. I would have done what I had to do. I would have been brave. And I know this about myself now. I'm older. And that really helped me a lot to know this.
Tell me what he says. When did he first see the helicopter?
How? Cool. When I you later. Yeah. He is that bit area.
That's where the helicopter was. When did he first see the helicopter? When? After, how long after it was shot down?
Chú nhìn thấy hay nhìn thấy trực tiếp hay là chú không chú hỏi thật chú ở đâu?
Tôi ở đây lần tôi không thấy được.
About 10 years ago.
Áo nơi đâu là còn chưa đến nè.
He bring some steel from helicopter for sale. We earn money.
Okay, good, good. That's okay. When ask him the piece that he sold, what did it that he took to sell? What did it look like?
Yeah, cảnh quạt đó.
Vâng ạ. The wing still left.
Yeah, yeah. And a big one or a small one?
Dài dài bao nhiêu, rộng bao nhiêu?
Không bán rồi.
Cái miếng nó dài bao nhiêu? 2 meters.
2 meters.
2 meters.
Gần 3 mét.
Oh,
more than 2 meters.
Yeah. Good.
Bruce Jones was along, and he had a GPS with it, and he documented everything, took readings, documented exactly points and places where each and whatever was found.
2830.
Spend 5 5 6 hours.
No, make that 2831. Okay.
Going up on there.
Archaeologists frequently use informants because they may have been an eyewitness to something that you no longer can see any evidence of. Just within what seemed like no time at all, we were beginning to see scraps of aircraft wreckage. The aircraft come apart, it's a messy business, and there's bits and pieces of aircraft everywhere.
It's from the armor seat that they sit on. We'll ask Chuck about it, but he'll recognize it.
I don't know.
Yeah. Ask him if there's more pieces up there of other things.
As I was walking across the face of the hill, I saw an object that was about 2 feet square. So as I got closer, I see the mesh of fiberglass. I recognize this thing as part of the armor plating that we used to carry and set our ammo boxes on. We also found, and the thing that really nailed it down, that this is a Bravo Troop 1st of the 9th Loach bird, a piece of fiberglass. On the side of the bird, we would paint, in Bravo Troop, we used a yellow square painted on the back side of that fiberglass is a portion of a yellow square.
I saw myself what I thought was a portion of a flag jacket.
Working it one way at a time. We got to let Bruce mark it. Hang on just a minute.
It was nylon, had a button on it. This was definitely the crash site of that helicopter.
Their recollections sit right on top of one another. There's no variation in it at all. And this, to me, was just absolutely astounding. These guys, 40 years after the fact, could sit down and draw a map that indicated the bomb crater where their buddy was and where the dead man lay and where they were and where the high ground was and the low ground and where were the North Vietnamese guns. Here it is. Here is where they lay.
Their names are Whitmire and Gervais and Martin.
Start me. Call in. Attention to roll. Major Chiloli.
Here, First Sergeant.
Sergeant First Class Hubler.
Here, First Sergeant.
Lieutenant Kenny.
Here, First Sergeant.
Sergeant Jervis. Sergeant Donald Jervis. Sergeant Donald P. Jervis. Corporal Martin. Corporal Richard Martin. Corporal Richard D. Martin. Warrant Officer Whitmire. Warrant Officer Warren Whitmire. Warrant Officer Warren T. Whitmire.
A lot of years have gone by, and a lot of questions still remain for a lot of families.
We do have a grave for him here, but there's no name on it yet, but nobody else is going to have that grave except for Dan. So we're going to bury him with my parents and my grandmother.
We've done our best, I think, to revisit the issue and try and find out why these fine soldiers have not been returned from their last place of duty. Their mission continues, and so does ours, to recover them.